Hello, this is George Perez, and you're listening to Southern Fried Geekery. And if you're hearing my voice, then you probably already know that.
Has anybody seen the movie Bad Lieutenant?
No.
No.
I don't think so.
So apparently this is a must-see. It's a Harvey Keitel movie. It's an old movie. It just hit Amazon Prime. Anyway, so I've got it queued up. Apparently it's all about, literally a bad lieutenant. A cop who's crazy and twisted as hell. And it's just, the whole movie's just him doing crazy, twisted, pervy shit.
This must be Harvey Keitel pre-Quentin Tarantino.
Oh, this is a long time before Quentin Tarantino. Quentin Tarantino is probably still a baby. It's an old movie.
Gotcha.
I've heard about it forever. Apparently there's some really psychologically weird shit going on in this movie.
In a Harvey Keitel movie? Really?
Yeah.
Go figure.
Hard to believe.
So that's queued up. As soon as the wife leaves town, I'm watching that.
She's like, get out. Yeah. Get out of my house. Yeah. Hurry up. Me and Harvey got a date.
Yeah.
Huh?
You know that when she turns on Prime, she can see what you've watched.
Right? Oh, yeah. She knows I watch all this stuff. I just can't watch it in her presence.
Makes
her cry.
If she's out of the house, he can still look her in the eye.
Yeah.
Zip code rule. For bad movies. No, not bad movies. Movies about disturbing, bad people.
Disturbing movies, yes.
Well, speaking of movies, you want to do a podcast?
Yeah.
All right, let's do this.
That was the most interesting segue into a comic podcast ever, right?
Especially this one. Hey, everybody, welcome back to another exciting episode of the Southern Fried Geekery Podcast. Before we go any further, do introductions or anything, I want to just express to you all that this is going to be a very spoiler-filled episode. We are going to talk about a movie that just came out, just hit theaters this week. It is Spider-Man Far From Home. So if you have not listened to that, or if you have not read certain comics like, I don't know, Walking Dead 193, which is kind of an important book, so they tell me, you might want to push pause. Save us for later. Put us in your podcast bank, as Matt likes to say, and come back and revisit us. Come back and revisit us later. But go do those two things, at least one of the two. So with that being said, I am Caleb Alexander McKenzie.
I'm Craig Lance.
I'm Sean.
Matt Trogdon.
And I'm excited about this, guys. I love when we get to talk about fresh movies, especially comic book movies.
Yeah,
words are hard at 10 a.m. on a Sunday.
Yeah.
I mean, I know you're new to this, right?
Yeah, no, it's my first time.
Day, yeah.
It is.
We either need more coffee or more alcohol, one or the other.
Those two things are not mutually exclusive. You can have both.
I get some Irish coffee going.
Yeah, right? you can, like, little Kahlua goes a long way.
Yes.
I hope everybody's had a good week. I'm excited about this. You know where you can come find us when you're not listening to us? Craig, I think you know. You have this gleam in your eye like you might know. Why don't you tell them where they can come find us when they're not listening to the podcast?
Facebook. Uh-huh. Instagram.
Uh-huh.
Twitter.
Uh-huh.
I feel like there's at least three or four. Our email.
Yeah.
Which is at southernfriedgeekery@gmail.com.
Yes, sir.
And what else am I missing?
I think that's about it.
Yeah.
You can always drop comments on our YouTube channel that we have, but nobody reads those. So,
yes, I forgot YouTube. You can't find us on YouTube.
Yeah, you're pissing in the wind if you leave us YouTube comments, because we're not checking those.
Sean might be. I'm not. Are you checking them, Sean?
Okay. No.
Yeah, come to our Facebook page if you want to leave a message, because no one cares what you say on YouTube.
It's awesome. It's a great group. It's got people from all over the country. Actually, it's got people from all over the planet. We've got a few people who live outside of the United States there. And it's rad. And we're talking about news. We're talking about books that we're reading. Different things going on in comic zeitgeist. It's awesome. And you can be a part of that by coming and liking that group. It's awesome.
It is.
Did I mention it's awesome?
It is awesome.
I've said that word like seven times.
Awesome.
I had four cups of coffee this morning.
Awesome.
Yeah. It's great. How's everybody's week been, guys?
I did an adulting thing yesterday.
Oh, yeah?
Probably the most adult thing I've done in a long time. Stephanie and I went and got a gas grill.
Nice.
So, I haven't had one since I moved to this house. We left our old one at the old house, and we keep thinking, it'd be nice if we had a grill. So we went yesterday and finally got one and got it set up.
I mean, it's prime cookout season.
It is. So
we throwing some ribs on it. Is that what happened?
Yeah.
Excited. I enjoy meat.
Yes.
It's great. Smoked.
Yes.
Covered in sauce.
Actually, this particular.
We've heard all this before, I think.
This particular gas grill does have a smoker deal in it. You can put some hickory chips and water in it and smoke your meat at the same time you grill. Yeah.
Just out of curiosity, what kind did you get?
DynaPro or something like that. Yeah. It was, the Home Depot special.
Nice.
It was what was on sale, but it was nice 5-burner, and we're excited. We were going to grill last night, but it rained on the way home from Home Depot, so we decided to put it off.
Yeah. Can't grill in the rain. That's no fun.
Well, if you're a real man, you could.
It's it was more the thunder that was happening.
Craig's outside wrapped in an American flag sarong with some tongs, firing up the grill while the torrents rain down.
Until that lightning strike from Caddyshack has hit.
I follow the rules of the flag code. I don't wear the flag.
Like a good man.
Good we man. Fly a flag.
Uh-huh.
We do not wear flags.
There you go. Anybody else?
I celebrated our holiday of freedom by working against my will at my job.
Okay.
Well, that was a pretty good week.
Nice.
I read a ton of comics.
Did you?
I haven't read this many comics in this short amount of time in a long time.
Well, speaking of short and comics, why don't you go ahead and just drop your short stack on us real quick. Tell me what three books you read this week, just off the top of your head.
Boom Studios, Bone Parish number 10.
Mm-hmm.
A good book.
Those are so good.
Yeah. It just keeps getting weirder.
Uh-huh.
Right up my alley. It's weird, scary. It's about a crime family in Nolens. Loving it. Cullen Bunn, Jonas Scharf, and Alex
Yarmus.
That one.
Mm-hmm.
And also read Image Comics Analog number 6, continuation from the first Analog arc by... Now,
I would have swore you were going to say from Analog number 5.
Yeah. As it do.
Yeah,
as it do.
So, yeah, it's also that. In the credits, the creative team omits their first name. So, you know, in honor of that, their last names, the creative team is Dugan, O'Sullivan, Spicer, and Sabino. And also what I went back and read about 10 old 2000 AD comics.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Nice. I bought about 20 of them off of eBay a while back. Going all the way back, this first issue came out in 1977. Ooh. So I read about...
Was anybody else alive at the table besides me?
No.
That outdates me by a year. These comics are a year older than me. So the issues I read were sporadic from 77 through the most recent issue I read was 83. Of course, they're printed on the cheapest newsprint paper available at the time. So they're very delicate. I couldn't even have a fan blowing on me while reading them. They're so delicate, but writers like Pat Mills, Jerry Finley Day, Alan Grant, who a lot of people know from the old Lobo series, somebody named T.B. Grover. I'm not totally sure that's not another writer using an alias because they did that back in 2000 AD. Yeah, they had the same writers writing all the time, but they didn't want it to seem too redundant. So some of these guys would use aliases in their credits. Interestingly enough, early in 2008, there are no credits on the issues.
No, yeah.
Those came later due to Pat Mills' insistence. Art by Cam Kennedy, Carlos Esquira, Ian Gibson, and Kevin O'Neill were the big hitters back in the day. But really interesting to go back and read these old books, man.
Man, it doesn't get any better than Carlos Esquira. I love that man. When he passed away, I think last year before last, it just rocked my little heart.
Yeah. Kevin O'Neill is the one. I really like Kevin O'Neill.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Those books are gold, dude.
Yeah. Most people know him from League of the Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice.
Well, Sean, what'd you read this week, brother?
I read Sea of Stars, number 1, from Image Comics. It's written by Jason Aaron and Dennis Hallam, and with art by Stephen Green. A good start to a series I was already interested in, so I'm glad I picked that one up and going to look forward to that. It's also new anime season, so I got a couple of shows I want to recommend real quick. Can I read subtitles so it counts? One is Sacred Beasts. When a country is divided up into a civil war and the losing army wants to start experimenting on their soldiers, turn them into monsters, it goes awry. And it looks like a very interesting anime I'm looking forward to. And Fire Force Episode number 1. This is based on the manga from creator Atsushi Okubo, who's known for Soul Eater. Fight fire with fire. When spontaneous human combustion will turn into a fire demon, only pyrokinetics can fight it back. So, really good start to another brand new anime.
Cool. Craig, brother.
George, I read Green Lantern number 9 with Grant Morrison, Liam Sharp, and Stephen Olaf. The art alone is worth this book, but Grant Morrison is probably writing some of what I consider to be his best stuff, yeah. which is saying something, because he's either really good or he's way too out there for me. But this Green Lantern run's been really good.
If you like 2000 AD stuff, go read Grant Morrison stuff now, because it's like the spiritual successor to it. It's fucking bananas.
Well, and Liam Sharp is just killing it on pencils.
Oh, it's gorgeous, man.
Space Bandits number one, Mark Millar and Matteo Scalera. Mark Millar is very hit or miss to me, especially lately.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like he's become more of an idea guy than a story guy. This particular book really drew me in, and part of it was the art on it. Matteo Scalera is amazing as well. Mm-hmm. If you're not familiar with him, he did Low, I believe, with Rick Remender.
I haven't read that, so I'm not sure.
I think that's the last book he was on, with Rick Remender. But yeah, very, very talented artist. You should check this book out for the art alone, mm-hmm. if nothing else. But it's Mark Millar. It started off really good, so I'm interested to see where it goes. Last was Star Wars Target Vader by Robbie Thompson and Chris Soulson. And a number of colorists were involved on it, so I'm not going to list all 30 colorists. But yeah, this is a story about Vader at the beginning of the rebellion, and there's a group of kind of the worst bounty hunters that are being put together by a group called the Black Hand, I believe it was, which is a group that is helping supply weapons to the rebellion, and he's trying to stop them. Well, they actually put together a group of kind of outlawed bounty hunters to go after Vader.
Yeah.
And Dengar's part of that group, which is really kind of crazy to me, because it's going to be interesting to see how he doesn't get destroyed by Vader and is still alive for Empire Strikes Back.
What's a Dengar?
Dengar is the old man bounty hunter in Empire Strikes Back that's standing there with all like the bandages on him and the armor.
Gotcha. Okay.
So,
brief bit of Star Wars trivia just for me.
it's a start of a series. It wasn't in itself a great book, but it's going to lead to a very compelling story. I agree.
Yeah. I'm in.
Nice. Well, I read Marjane Satrapi's Persepolis this week. That's a really...
Those sounded like words.
Yeah, they are. So what Persepolis is the retelling of essentially what happened to Iran in the late 60s, moving through the 80s and 90s. At one point in time, Iran, and forgive me if I'm not saying that right. I know with Middle Eastern countries, the Americanized way we say the names are often wrong. Iraq. I fumble over.
I grew up as Iran, but yeah. They say it differently.
George Bush fucked up the way we say those names, because he Texasized everything. Anyway, so it's essentially at one point in time, Iran was kind of the westernized jewel of the Middle East, and then through some politics and revolutions, it became what it was, at least in my lifetime, which is a caliphate, a very controlled religious state. And honestly, there are some pretty terrifying parallels to what's happening in our country right now. And, history, if you don't study it, you're doomed to repeat it. So go check that out if you want to shit your pants, essentially.
I mean, those of us that study history are just, doomed to watch it happen again by the idiots that don't.
So. Nope. Faux show. In a not necessarily more lighthearted vein, but at least in a more fictional, fun, energetic vein, I read the first volume of the 100 Bullets Deluxe Edition trade paperback, which I think is the first 18 issues. I don't know. There's five volumes. I read all through the first hardcover. 100 Bullets by Brian Azzarello and Eduardo Risso. If you like Sin City, it's more like an urbanized Sin City. Essentially, the premise is there is a clandestine organization that goes around and finds people who have been wronged in their life. They drop them off an attaché case. It's got 100 bullets and a gun. And, if they use it, anytime somebody, like when the forensic goes in, they get to walk off scot-free. Nothing happens. So they just, whatever. If you use this bullet, the bullets are untraceable. They will not come back to you. You can shoot somebody on, in the middle of Manhattan and in front of a parade of cops and they find that bullet. You just get to walk out in a few hours like nothing happened. It's amazing. Incredible book. And then last but certainly not least, a new book that just came out and is on the shelves right now, Captain America and the Invaders. And this book is by the legendary team of Roy Thomas and Jerry Ordway, but it's a new book. Like, those are old names, but this is at least I'm assuming it's a new book. There may be a script and some art they've had laying around forever. But it's so good, man. It's a gem of a book. It is very reminiscent of the Captain America of old, the way that they used to tell those stories, very action packed. He's fighting Nazis, which is always nice to see Nazis get fucking stabbed. I've stepped my punch game up. Just go ahead and stab him. You heard that here first. I'm going to get sued.
That's a hot take.
All right, yeah, stabbing Nazis.
Stabbing Nazis. I want stickers.
That's a bold statement this day and age.
Fuck them. But yeah, so go check that. It's a good book. I mean,
we had a war about it. Everybody was invited and bought it. Right.
Hey, we get to do that. We had a war about it. That's an amazing statement. But no, I mean, it had the greats in there. It had had the Human Torch, the original Human Torch in it. Had my boy Namor in it. So fun times all around.
The original Human Torch, wasn't he an android?
He was. Yep.
And he was indeed. Sidekick.
He did, yes. He,
I'm trying to think of his name.
Namor was the only one of those people that didn't have a sidekick. Because right. Cap had Bucky. I can't remember his name. He got killed.
Yeah, I don't think he lasted
pretty
long.
Unceremoniously. But it was fun stuff.
I love that Human Torch was an android.
Mm-hmm. It's also, they used his body to make the Vision.
Yep.
Yep. Little bit of history on that. So,
I thought they used Ultron.
No. They used, no.
You mean the movie wasn't correct?
Mm-mm. Oh. We don't talk about that. We don't, no, we're not going there. Speaking of movies, because you segued, this is your last opportunity to turn us off before we spoil the shit out of Spider-Man Far From Home. So I'm going to count you down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I didn't get to do a countdown earlier.
Taking too long.
I love countdowns. All right. Spider-Man Far From Home. That is our.
2, 1. Sorry.
Everything we just did is wrong. It's an abomination. Spider-Man Far From Home, starring Tom Holland as Peter Parker and Spider-Man, Samuel L. Jackson as Nick Fury, Jake Gyllenhaal as Quentin Beck and Mysterio, Marissa Tomei as the hot as shit May Parker, John Favreau as the Happy Hogan, Zendaya as Mary Jane, Jacob Batalon as Ned Leeds, and some other folks playing some friends of his.
Some people that did some things.
The Scooby Gang, if you will. So in this story, which is, I think it's important to note, it is the wrap up. It's the final film in the Marvel's Phase 3, takes place, as you might expect, after the fallout from Avengers Endgame. The kids are all trying to get back to normal life. They're trying to get their shit back together, so to speak, after what they are calling the blip, which is the 5-year expanse to where 50% of the universe's population turned to dust, and then they came back. And so you've got some kids who were not blipped, and they are much older, as in there's one character, and I forget his name. He's not necessarily an important figure. It's Remy Hill. He plays a character called Brad Davis. He was not blipped, so he's now these characters' same age. He was 5 years younger than them when they were turned to dust, and now he's back, and he's hot. And he's after MJ, which is no good. It's no good for Spidey. The rest of them came back, and although they should be roughly about 23 or 24, they're 21. Still 21, yeah.
Because they even make that joke.
They do. Right. They're still 16.
Yes.
And so they're still being treated like 16-year-olds. And so you have this mashup of people trying to make their way, in the school system. Pete's getting back into class, and as some high schools do, I guess this is either a science club or a science class, something. They get together and they decide that they're going to take a little trip. They are going to go on a little bit of a European tour.
Which, when I think science, I always think, you know, yeah, let's go on a science trip to Italy.
Maybe it's a history, but like they mention science.
It's a science club.
Because they take the science teacher with them.
So it's both science teachers. It's weird.
And a lot of high schools do this. I know the high school that I went to, they went on a European tour. My husband, when he was in high school, his like senior class got to go on a European tour.
I tried to go to France with my French class, but at least that made sense.
Yeah.
I did not.
Have those things at Cabot High.
No. I did get to go on some pretty cool, like, inside the United, like, we went to Washington, D.C. Right. We went to the East Coast. We went to some places I just never got to travel out.
Yeah. We only got to travel at Wilbur D. Mills High School in Old Main whenever there was just a bomb threat or a gang war going on. We had to trip out of there.
They took y'all to Little Rock instead of North Rock to explore that.
I'm old enough that I got to go home from school because of smog alerts.
Oh, wow.
In California.
Oh, that's amazing.
We were stuck in the middle of getting under your desk from earthquakes and getting under your desks from, you know, shotguns.
Nuclear bombs.
Yeah. So they go on this trip. They start off in Vienna. They're going to go to Paris. They're going to go to Prague. I mean, they're going to take a little whirlwind tour of Eastern and Western Europe. And that's essentially the impetus of the story. Spider-Man's excited because he's tired of being a hero. He's ready for a break. He needs some time off. You know, his aunt May, is actually doing some really, really great charitable work.
She blipped as well.
She did. And she came back. And as you might imagine, this is one of the cool things that they actually got right in the movie. I feel like when something happens and you're gone for 5 years, life moves on, whether you want it to or not. So they get in there and some people are, the people are living in other people's houses and relationships have moved on, right, and people have been displaced. And so what she's doing is she's working to make sure that they are taken care of, that they're, you know, the people who come back are not forced into homelessness. They can deal with the trauma.
And she actually came back and her house was
right.
Her apartment had been being used.
Yeah. And that's, I guess, her calling. And she's using Spider-Man to help raise money because he's a hero after all. He's the successor to Tony Stark in many ways. And so he's doing these public appearances. He's kissing babies and shaking hands and doing photo ops. And he's just kind of worn out. He misses being the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. He wants to go back to those days. And so he's really excited about leaving his suit at home and going on this trip.
Not being a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
Just being a kid, man. He's excited about being a kid again. Yeah. You know what else he's excited about?
Mary Jane.
Mary motherfucking Jane. Played by Zendaya, who is an awesome actress. Yeah. He's really hoping.
She's not a white redhead.
She's not. She is, in fact.
You just reminded the internet to be angry again. Thanks, Craig.
Do they actually ever call her Mary Jane?
They don't. They just call her MJ.
Yeah, okay. But it's MJ.
I get it. Somebody asked me that, and I was like, I don't think I didn't make a note of it.
Homecoming, and I forget what her real name was, but it was something else.
Isn't it?
Michelle, something. Like, and she said, my friends call me MJ. Yeah. So she's not actually Mary Jane.
Yeah. But while all of this is happening, while they're planning the trip, they're doing these photo ops, Spider-Man's being Spider-Man. Also, they don't explain it, but somehow he has lost his spider sense.
That's one of my favorite.
They don't really explain that too much. While all this is going on, down in Mexico, there's been an event. A village, a small township has been completely obliterated by, I guess, a sandstorm, a whirlwind. But you see Maria Hill and Nick Fury show up and they're kind of inspecting it, which is kind of weird because it's just a natural event, right? Except for the reports are saying this natural event had a face. The storm itself was personified.
I was under the impression it had already happened.
Yeah, it had.
And they're going down there to investigate and then it happens again
over
there.
That's exactly what happens.
Showing up just thinking it's going to happen.
No, they were there. Like I said, the township has been wrecked. It's already taken place. And so they show up there and then, like you just said, the monster attacks again and this new figure shows up to help fight it and he's cloaked. You know, he's green clad. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, the monster that attacked while they were there was an earth elemental. Like it was like the wind destroyed it before, but when they're there, you see the ground rise up into a monster made of the earth.
So yeah.
You have another element kicking.
So. Uh huh. And the figure who shows up to fight it is this kind of green and purple clad figure with a bubble on his head. And it's, he doesn't really have a name. They don't know what to call him, but his name is Quentin Beck. He's played by Jake Gyllenhaal. And if you are familiar at all with Spider-Man cartoon or with comics, you'll know that this is Mysterio, but he's not the Mysterio you know. Apparently, he is from another dimension. When the snap happened, his story at least is that it opened up a rift and the multiverse is
real. They didn't
say
that though. That was only in the trailer.
They didn't say that it happened at the snap.
They said he was from another universe, but they never said it had anything to do with the snap in the movie.
I thought they did. I thought they was just a sentence. No, okay. Either way, they open up the door for the multiverse thing. And that's how he's explaining that he's here and that these elementals have destroyed his planet and everything that he loves and holds dear, that killed his family. Just really tragic story. And so he's jumped over into our Earth, which they call Earth 616, which by the way, this universe is not Earth 616. The movie universe is its own. It's like Earth 10-9999 or something.
Well, the comic
like that.
Universe isn't Earth 616 anymore.
Well, no, it's not any longer. Lots of little Easter eggs there for comic fans.
Tons throughout this entire movie.
And they're working through all this. And Nick Fury and Maria Hill, they're going to work with him. And, you know, who do they go to get help? Well, you know, Thor's gone doing Thor stuff. Tony and Cap are no more. The Avengers are kind of wrecked. So they go to get Spider-Man. He's kind of the liaison, I guess, or the person that.
And conveniently enough, he's in Europe.
Yeah. And he's going to be there. And the funny part is Nick Fury is trying to get a hold of Peter, and Peter just ghosts him time and time again. He shady buttons the shit out of him. He doesn't want to talk to him. Happy shows up. It's like, hey, you're going to get a phone call. He's like, yeah, I don't want to talk to him. He's like, I just want to be a kid. And all of this is going to take place while they're over in Europe. And so they go. And that's where the shenanigans happen. When they're in, I guess it's, where are they
did
at
you say first? Shenanigans?
Shenanigans.
Oh, okay.
Shenanigans take place.
Are we making up words, Steph?
So I think if memory serves right, they go to Vienna first.
Yes.
And Vienna.
No, Venice.
Venice. I knew one of those cities. Yeah, because everything's sinking. They show up. It's kind of this high school rom-com-esque, very tropey. They get there. The place that was booked by their half-wit teachers is one of those places that's sinking. It's just kind of shithole.
It was a European vacation.
Yeah. Pretty
National Lampoon's European vacation.
And that's when, you know, these another elemental attack. It's a water elemental. It wrecks the city, and Pete can't not be a hero. So he jumps in to help, and Mysterio shows up. And this time they're actually calling him. They don't call him Mysterio, but this is where they kind of establish that that's what they're going to call him. He shows up. There's a big fight. You know, good guys win. Everybody claps. Move on to the next city. Yay! And they kind of just shuffle through. In the meantime, you know, Pete has these really touching moments with MJ. He almost kills another kid when they're on a bus because he's using some Stark technology because Happy gives him some glasses.
No, Tony Stark gave him the glasses.
Hmm?
But Happy Tony Stark gave him the glasses.
They were left worn by Tony Stark, but right. Happy did give him the
same Happy bring. Yeah, I'm sorry. Happy brings him the Stark glasses, yes. I should say. And it's got a link to essentially a Friday-esque figure. What did they call it?
Edith.
Edith.
Which is an acronym for Even Dead, I'm the Hero.
Yeah.
Which I love. That killed me.
Pure Tony Stark fashion. Oh. And while he's trying to figure all this out, he accidentally sicks a space attack drone to kill that poor bastard played by Brad Davis, who's hitting on MJ, and stops it just in the nick of time. You can see, like, he's not used to this. It's very childlike, very Spider-Man-esque, very lighthearted.
Him getting
things.
Himself in trouble.
Yeah, and then having to get himself out.
It's very much a Spider-Man feel.
Yeah. Without getting into too much of the detail, because you can go see the movie for yourself, as you might have figured, everything is not what it seems. Quentin Beck is not a hero.
Quentin, he's not from another universe.
No, he's from this one. In fact, he is from this universe and was once an employee of Tony Stark. And if you remember, if you hearken back to some of the earlier movies where you get that scene where Tony is delivering a speech and he's looking at his younger self.
I believe it was Civil War.
Was it? Yeah, okay. He's looking at this hologram of his younger self with his family. Quentin Beck is one of the people who helped figure this technology out, and it's drone technology. And that is actually what is happening with Mysterio. All of these elementals are not elementals at all.
Well, the funny thing is that Tony Stark gave it the acronym for crap, which is what pissed Quentin Beck off, as he called
And Tony taking credit for all of it. I mean, there was a lot of things. And he's not the only one they've pissed off. There's an entire functioning team of special effects people.
Employees.
Who are disgruntled, man. This is the league of disgruntled employees who have teamed up together to essentially that what they want to present is Mysterio as a hero to on an Avengers level scale. I guess they're going to monetize it. There's no real understanding of what they had planned to do once they reached the Avengers level, because at some point he would have to be, you know, fight alongside the Avengers, and well, that would just lead to a whole lot of discovery of, well, he's not really a hero.
Rip people off.
They were going to EVS the shit. They were going to get money. they were going to comic skate the hell out of everybody and get money and
promise
produce
comic books and
shit. Yeah, produce no results, which is just funny. Like he's insane. He doesn't really have a plan. They're just going to do what they do.
He's going to be a bad guy.
They, you know, and he's working with. He's got somehow, and I mean, we learn how later, but he's got Nick Fury fooled. He's got everyone in the intelligence community fooled. He's got all the superheroes fooled. No one gets what's happening, but you start to catch on. At least Pete does, because he starts to realize that these drones are the same. Like they Zendaya, her MJ, she finds a camera that breaks off, and they start to put the puzzle pieces together that this everything is not what it seems.
Unfortunately, Peter's already given Mysterio the sunglasses.
He handed him over the keys to Edith, which is going to allow him to step his game up, which is, at least in my brain, and we'll get to this later, not necessarily because he already had the drone technology. I guess he just gave him like an unlimited supply.
Well, he gave him weaponized drones,
yeah,
which he didn't have.
Yeah, it was the same drone, though.
Maybe the amount of them.
Right. Like, he gave him a satellite supply of them. Essentially, he was able to step his drone game up and create a major event, which goes on to wreck London.
It was a MacGuffin.
Yeah.
Had to have a MacGuffin because it's a Marvel movie.
You know, they're following the formula. In London, the big fight happens. Somehow the kids get locked in with the crown jewels because it's really easy to run in there with them during an event where the city's being attacked. They're just going to leave that open. Oh, no, it is. And on a normal day, you can actually go tour that. Yes. You can go see the crown jewels, but they lock that shit down when the city's being bombed, apparently. Anyway, they're in there. Drones are attacking. Spidey, Pete catches on to, Quentin Beck, Mysterio's plans. They work to against him. Nick Fury gets a phone call from Happy where he's like, hey, everything is not what he seemed. Happy's trying to use some coded language. It works.
Yeah.
Maria Hill bazooka's a drone just because she's Maria Hill, kinda. the day is saved. Quentin Beck is defeated. Yay! Everybody claps. Except we live in a post-truth world. We live in a world where fake news is rampant, where people are codified to not believe what they see. They're codified to believe what they hear on television. And in his last moments, Mysterio records Spider-Man using some language. What he's telling Edith to shut the drones off, to execute the drones.
They re-pieced it together to make it.
And that is going to come in to play in an after credit scene. Once they get back, the vacation's over. MJ and Pete are having their little meet cute. They're in love. It's all sweet. The best relationship out of the whole movie, which was Ned and Betty Brant, who decided to have their European love affair. They break up on the plane ride home. There's just lots of these little really teenage cute moments. And it ends with Pete going back to being his friendly neighbor.
But you cannot talk about who was J. Jonah Jameson.
Well, yeah, we're going to get to that. So part of what happens in that after credit scene is Mysterio has, like you said, put together this clip, framing Spider-Man as the bad guy. Even though, like I said, it happened in the middle of one of the largest cities in the world, but he framed Spider-Man as a bad guy, even though everyone saw him, everyone saw Mysterio being evil. He's able to broadcast this across planet where he not only positions Pete as being the villain, but he unmasks him. And he does this through a character who's kind of like an Alex Jones-esque figure at the time. He's running something called the DailyBugle.com, which is a web news site. But it's J. Jonah Jameson, and he's played by none other, and I forget.
J.K. Simmons.
Yeah, J.K. Simon, who was the.
Simmons. Yeah.
Who was the J. Jonah Jameson of the Sam Raimi Spider-Man movies.
Yes.
So it's kind of looping that back in there.
Yeah, to me, it just shows that the Spider-Verse is real.
Yeah.
And that there is actually multiverses.
Well, it's funny to me how the audience, when I was watching the movie, responded. Everybody in the theater, started clapping. Yeah, and I was sitting there thinking, wow, J. Jonah Jameson is getting this kind of response out of an audience.
Yeah. But that guy, I mean, I think J.K. Simmons is born to play.
I think it was more the J.K. Simmons getting the reaction.
Oh, I popped
well,
for
yeah,
it.
Well, yeah, I get it. It's really funny to me. That's the world we live in now.
Yeah. That the dirtbag reporter's getting the.
Well, no, it's just a character like that. Oh, yeah. Right. That nobody knew about that character.
Oh,
a mass audience
didn't
know about that character. 15 years ago, whatever, it's just, I'm constantly amazed at how this
geekdom
stuff
has become
pop culture, common knowledge, basically.
Yeah. and I mean, he's born to play.
Oh, perfect.
J. Jonah Jameson. Yeah. So I don't know who else you would have brought in to play him, but you do totally open the door for there being a multiverse, even though none of that really existed in this movie.
I just wish they had given him a toupee.
I'm okay.
I mean, like in the Sam Raimi movies, he looked exactly like my idealized version of of that character. In this one, he like you know it's him because he played him before, but now he like he's bald.
Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah, no, it's fine.
It's a different universe.
I've got nothing against bald men. Obviously, I'm besties with you, but I just I miss that.
Some of my best friends are bald.
I'm flanked by them, but I do miss the visage from those movies.
Oh,
but
yeah,
that wasn't the only after credits scene. There's another one that took place at the very 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 end, and if you were like me, you were watching
credits and post credits,
right?
As Jerry would remind
right.
us,
right? He would. By the way, Jerry is still off gallivanting in the Pacific Northwest, and we miss him. We love you, buddy. Come back. If you're watching this movie,
none of us are going to second that.
Stay your ass there.
If you're watching this movie, if you were me, as I was watching this film, I was confused. I did not like the way that at least two characters were being written. Nick Fury did not seem like Nick Fury at all to me. It was very, very poorly written. Maria Hill, in that same vein, I thought was being very poorly written and portrayed. In the very end credit scene, you see Nick Fury and Maria Hill driving in a car, and it turns out they're Skrulls. They are, in fact, they're the Skrulls from the Captain Marvel movie.
Talos is the dude's name, but I can't remember the other ones.
No, it's one of his, like, second in commands. And that's why. And Nick Fury is actually off in space doing something. We don't know what.
So the internet actually picked up on this before the movie ever came out,
mm-hmm.
because in one of the Avengers movies,
Ultron,
he says, I can only eat my sandwiches cut diagonally.
Oh.
And in Captain Marvel, he's eating it regular.
Okay.
So
deep cut.
Yeah. So somebody picked up on that and has figured out that he's been off and on a Skrull.
Yeah.
Throughout this whole time.
Talos has been, being him at certain moments whenever it, as was revealed in the end credit, where, when he's off doing other things.
Yeah. So, did I gloss over anything important, any mega important events? I tried to give a good understanding of the movie without, even if you haven't seen it.
And beyond the reveal that Talos is being Fury, we find out Fury is out in space now, which I think is opening the door, obviously, to the Marvel cosmic stuff happening in the next phase.
Yeah, for sure. I think that there was a line earlier in the movie that I think was put in there for a specific group of people.
Yeah.
And it's when Fury is trying to get Peter to help him. And Peter's like, what about Captain Marvel? And he says something like, don't say her name or something. It was like,
you don't invoke her name.
Her name is what he says. Like, you're not worthy enough to say her name.
Yeah, that was definitely a hint. Yeah.
And so then when it's revealed that it's actually Talos, it makes 1,000%
right.
Yeah.
Sense that why he said that, because, she saved his people. So
also the first time she's been referred to as Captain Marvel in the MCU.
So, just real quick, and I'll start with me, but I'll kind of go around the table and give a little bit of a ranking. How do we want to do this? Like, out of 5 stars?
I don't think 5 is enough.
Letter
because
grade.
If you do 3 out of 5, that's a D, and I think this is better than
that. Do we want to do a letter grade?
I'd maybe give it a letter grade or something.
Yeah. Okay. I would give this a B-. Not quite a C, but a B-. Matt?
I'd give it a B+.
Okay.
Give it an A.
A?
I'd probably give it an A-.
Okay.
I have some issues with the movie. They're not huge issues. But, for the most part, I really enjoyed this movie. I liked a lot of things they did with it. I think that it made perfect sense. I wondered when they had announced that this was the last movie of Phase 3. Like, that doesn't make any sense. Why are you going to have a movie post-Endgame?
Mm-hmm.
Why not just start with the next? Well, this starts to... I 100% thought they were going to gloss over the stuff that happened with the blip.
Yeah.
As they're calling it now. I thought they were just going to kind of pretend that nothing really happened and the world's okay again and now the world's... They are absolutely not doing that, number one. Number two, they're addressing the fact that they have a vacuum in the leadership for the Avengers in this movie because... While you still have a Captain America, you don't have Steve Rogers.
Right.
Tony Stark's not there. Who's going to lead the Avengers? And they're trying to push Peter to be that person. Well, I don't think he's going to be. No. I think it's going to be Sam. But they want Peter to step up and take that role. There's some people that are upset over him using Stark tech. I think it's perfectly fine. And, mm-hmm. and it plays out perfectly fine within yeah. this concept of this movie. It maybe doesn't play out fine within our concept of the comic books. But even in the comic books, Tony gives him equipment all the time. So it yeah. happens. And Peter's straight up a genius.
Well, and he's using,
shows that in this.
Yeah. He's using the Stark suit throughout the first part of the film. I mean, yes. He's still very much tied into being that...
And he's using the Stark suit at the end of the film.
Yeah.
So it's, you know... I think that they did a good job of transitioning that. And I'm okay with him having having access to Stark technology based on how they did it in the film.
Mm-hmm. So on that, using as far as at the end of the movie... Now, the way I saw that is he used Stark tech to build essentially a traditional Spider-Man suit.
He built his own suit.
He didn't build himself another iron suit.
No, right.
Exactly.
Yes. I really appreciated
yes.
that, because that's one of the things that's a minor hang-up that the Iron Spider stuff kind of bums me out a little bit, because it takes away from what Spider-Man can do in just a spandex outfit and a couple of
right.
string bracelets.
I kind of think that Edith will be integrated into a suit in the next movie.
Yeah. And see, that kind of bums me out.
I'm with you on that.
You know, yeah. Let Spider-Man do a Spider-Man thing.
Because he's still inherently human. But one of the things I did like about that, because one of my major issues with this version of Spider-Man is that we forget that he's a genius. Like Spider-Man, at least my Spider-Man in the books, he's a genius. Don't underestimate his mental prowess, because he is the creator of all the technology that he uses. And he's a scientist. And this version is not that. He is a smart, he's a smart kid, but at least in the way they've shown him up until this point, he's only just as smart as the rest of people around him. He's only as, you know, he's the head of the science club, but he's not.
I disagree.
Yeah.
I disagree. They're showing him as an awkward teenager,
yeah.
but he's still a genius.
Yeah. He's.
They're showing him. And even Mysterio says something, because when he's talking to Mysterio and he says, "Oh, I'm sorry," because everybody's like, "Can we move on?" Mysterio says, "Don't ever apologize for being the smartest person in the room."
Right. Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying. This movie portrays him as
this movie.
Before this movie, yeah. He didn't make his own Spider-Man suit. Tony handed him half the ship that he needed. Suit. Well, he had underoos.
Yeah, that's the thing.
That's what a teenager would do.
Yeah, that's what was so great. I mean, he had to make it in his apartment. So he made yeah. the bracelets. He made webbing, which is
the web fluid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But as far as his suit goes, that's what I really appreciate, is the only tech he had were his bracelets that shoot webs.
Right.
You know,
my problem was before this is that
he was getting too much help.
Yeah, that was it.
Everything, I have the same problem.
Yes, he started off as in a shoddily clad suit, but then he made everything else. This version of Pete didn't do that. We got him handed to him.
But we got him before Tony got to him in this version mm-hmm. of him before he really had a chance to establish himself.
Yeah.
Whereas in what we're used to is he had established himself.
Yeah.
And then went looking to join the Avengers or join the Fantastic Four.
And when he's on Tony's, it's essentially a Quinjet, and he's reprogramming things to make his own suit. That showed, he knows how to use this technology. Mm-hmm. He in fact does have he's smart. He's very intelligent.
Yeah. Yep. I really like that he was building the suit to that Lynyrd Skynyrd classic song, Back in Black.
Yeah.
It was Led Zeppelin.
Yeah. The joke, but still.
Yeah.
I cracked up on that
one. Right. No, it was good stuff.
So, my one issue with that when he leaves the Quinjet is his fucking parachute. And I'm okay with it on one hand being Stark, but Spider-Man makes his own fucking parachutes with webs.
Yeah. Right.
And I wanted to see that.
Yeah. I
did
love.
And they have the chance, and they use technology instead of webs.
Yeah. I did love that he had the underarm webbing, though, and it allowed him to.
I love that he used it as a glider type thing, as opposed to just being there to limit his mobility like it normally would.
So part of my
baiting. He's baiting.
That's bait. Part of why I didn't enjoy this as much as other people, I want to fully admit, is because I don't think this movie was made. It's not made for me, right? It's made for a younger crowd. It's made for people who like a little bit of a lighthearted movie. There, you know, several of the jokes, like you said, it was very National Lampoonish.
There was parts.
It seemed really, really silly, and I think unnecessarily so. That was just, and again, that's like that was a conscious
Spider-Man
choice. It just didn't
work
for me.
To be more lighthearted, though, in a Spider-Man situation. Even in an Avenger situation, Spider-Man's supposed to bring the levity to it, not Thor. And I think that that's something that I'm okay with in a Spider-Man movie.
I am if it was coming from Pete. So much of this, the levity didn't come from Pete. In those situations, it's the silly kid surrounded by very serious adults, and he's making light of their seriousness.
Or the stupid adults. The my biggest problem is the fact that how the hell are those two teachers, science teachers, and how the hell are they like, giving? How is anybody giving their kids permission to leave with those two adults?
I kept waiting. I kept waiting for the moment where we realized that at least one of the two teachers was undercover, where he was an undercover operative, maybe working with Nick Fury, and he was just playing a role. But it wasn't that. It was just turns out he's just that big of a doofus.
Yeah. Right.
And like that lessened my enjoyment when that never happened. Also, I have a question. And you know, I've watched Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And I'm caught up enough to know that S.H.I.E.L.D. no longer exists.
Yes.
S.H.I.E.L.D. is gone.
It's been gone since Civil War.
Who the fuck is Nick Fury supposed to be working for? Who's funding Nick
Fury?
He's
working for himself. Tony Stark money, I would imagine.
Maybe he's being low-key funded.
Yeah,
like
I think he's being funded by Stark Industries. And he's doing his own thing, and I personally don't believe we've had Nick Fury on Earth since the end of Civil War.
Very possibly not,
or since the end of Winter Soldier.
But in that vein,
when he leaves after they're at his gravesite, and he shows up, and then he leaves. I don't think Nick Fury's been on Earth since then. I think he's been in space with Captain Marvel.
But following that thread, if Nick Fury is being funded by Stark, if Nick Fury, you know, even though Stark is gone, if he's being funded by Stark Enterprises, wouldn't he have had the means at his disposal to say, hey, like, wouldn't somebody who was working for him, even him and Maria were Skrulls, somebody who works there would have seen him and go, hey, isn't that guy who used to work in the tech department? Isn't that guy who helped us come up with this technology? Why is he saying he's from another thing? Maybe that's not it. Like, that makes no sense. The fact that, like, Mysterio was already using the Stark tech, had worked for Stark. I get
it wasn't
that
Tony Stark.
If
it had been Tony Stark in this movie, then sure he would have recognized him.
I still think somebody, because this is so close to Stark.
It's a hint that it's not Nick Fury. Because Nick Fury legit knows everything.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it's your first hint that it's not Nick Fury, that he didn't figure out what was going on.
No, for sure. And again, that's why I want to know who quote unquote, and I'm using air quotes, Nick Fury is working for and how he's getting done. Because like, yes, Nick Fury is this super spy. He's the scariest person on Earth. Even the fake version of him is. And if it was an LMD, I maybe would have understood a little bit better. But plane tickets cost money. Like, he has to get to Mexico somehow. Like,
well, I think he's being funded by Stark Industries. Yeah. I mean, we know that Stark Industries is still a thing. Happy's still running it. Pepper's still running it. Happy is still in charge of security.
So wouldn't Happy have, like, and I get it, Happy's a fuck up, but wouldn't Happy or somebody who works for Happy notice that Jake fucking Gyllenhaal is?
Happy never saw him without his costume on. Not once in the movie did Happy see him without his costume.
Yeah.
Every time he was in public, he had his costume on.
Yeah, and Happy mainly interacted with Peter.
He was on the newscast. He was being shown as a hero on the news without his bubble on. He was not hiding his face from the world.
I don't remember that. So
and
maybe.
That's what one of my biggest problems. He wasn't.
Beard?
Maybe.
And he didn't win.
He wore glasses. He's Superman.
Happy's just not really worried about the day-to-day employees of Tony. He's only worried about keeping up
with
the
news.
He was in charge
of
security and maybe wasn't aware of what was going on in states, in the rest of the, you know, I mean, he's in charge of security for Stark Industries. He's not in charge of.
He had his hands full with Tony and not have to pay attention to any of these random ass
employees.
Matt gets what I'm saying. Somebody would have noticed that. Yeah. Like, there's a big.
But you're
like,
only talking about a group of eight people. This isn't S.H.I.E.L.D. You had eight people in that bunker. It wasn't the S.H.I.E.L.D. that you used to know, the group of spies that Tony used to have.
I think that, that's one hang up I had. And my hang ups are pretty minor with the movie. The movie is well made. We had to look at Jake Gyllenhaal's face way too much. It should have been the
There's
the
people that would argue with you about.
I'm aware. Believe me, I know
We had to look at Spidey's face way too much.
Yeah.
Quit taking the goddamn mask off.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we should have had the fishbowl. He shouldn't have been taking it off all the time. And you know, this is why I'm not so super crazy about big actors in these movies, because you know, best example I can give of that is the Stallone Judge Dredd movie. Got to see their damn face so we don't
Captain America hasn't worn a mask since the first Captain America.
Right, well, but that's Steve's not keeping his identity.
Yeah. Yeah, I get that.
But, you know, like I agree with you on a level. I also understand that sometimes you have to have the human face going, because a prime example a lot of people bring up is the first Sam Raimi Spider-Man. We have that whole sequence on the roof with Spider-Man and the Green Goblin. And it just like, and they both have their masks on the entire time. People like, this look like two action figures being shaken back and forth, because you can't emote through a mask. So they take them off for that.
Deadpool did.
Well,
yeah, it can happen.
Black Panther did. I was gonna say not everyone.
And I'm not saying don't. It's just done. It's just done too much for my taste. That's
so. I was actually okay with Mysterio taking his off at the times he did. I forgot that he was on the newscast. I'm gonna watch the movie again.
Yeah.
Obviously,
I may be wrong, but.
But even still, his whole point was to become an Avenger. Mm-hmm. He was trying to get publicity. He was trying to become famous. That was his whole goal. Spider-Man taking his mask off all the time. Standing on the bridge. I mean,
in major cities after mega terrorist events.
I'm wearing the same clothes I was wearing, but I'm going to put a Mardi Gras mask on, and no one will recognize in downtown Venice.
So that to me, I actually,
it was funny.
That was funny to me, because that's like, okay, yep, he's a kid. He thinks this is a good idea. So that
it didn't bother me. Yeah. I'm just saying that overall, he did stuff that was like, and like you said, he kept taking.
Yeah.
And it happens all the time, though, with superhero movies like that. Like, there'll be a major event still on top of a building where people can see, and they always take their masks off the monologue or soliloquy.
Inevitably, it doesn't matter, because he gets quote unquote unmasked anyway.
He does.
And so it was interesting to me, because this might be the first Marvel film to where the end credit scenes aren't extra. They're not just the cherry on top. They are
integral.
They are in. Happening. Yeah. You can't understand these movies without watching these two scenes. And I don't know that we've had that before. Maybe
both of them actually reflect back to the movie you just watched instead of.
Absolutely.
I mean, actually, the very last one where they're revealing that they're Skrulls, I think, does both things.
Mm-hmm.
It sets up what happened and where they're
going. It's a prologue and an epilogue.
Yeah.
They don't electrify you like the post credit scenes used to. Remember the old ones, like.
Right. Oh my God, there's Thanos.
They just found Thor's hammer.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. Yeah. That means we're getting a Thor movie. I mean, they're not, they're not.
Yeah, it's not. Again, the movie doesn't make any sense without the end credit scenes.
Right.
That's just bad writing on Nick Fury and Maria Hill without the end credit scenes. That's just.
But when you get the reveal, you're like, oh my fucking God, it makes so much sense now.
Right. But I don't. For me, and this is what, again, why I give the movie a B-. I don't need an extra minute and a half scene for. You shouldn't take that for the movie to make sense. It shouldn't take that to fix all the holes. That way we get to see, and again, I'm generally okay with seeing Tom Holland's face. I think it's hot, but it shouldn't take an end credit scene to make seeing his face okay so much, because he's standing in the middle of the London Bridge.
Him taking his mask off all the time was stupid.
Yeah.
And that doesn't really fix that. That just it's just.
Well, it makes it inconsequential.
Yes. So it's still that happened way too much throughout the movie. The Nick Fury and Maria Hill thing, if you hadn't found out, you would have just been like, okay, it was bad, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But the movie still makes sense. It was just, it seems awkward in places.
See if anybody else feels this way. One major hang up I had with this movie, and I had with Endgame too, is the amount of cussing that is in it. You know, now, obviously, cussing in itself doesn't bother me. However,
Matt trogged in the prude.
When you have that, I'm going to go, So when you have that in a Spider-Man movie, is it anybody else bothered by it? You know,
I didn't notice it. So
because I'm watching it thinking, okay, which kids can you not take to this movie now? Because you don't want them to, either, because that may bother you to hear your 6-year-old nephew hear. Am I alone on that?
I know what you're saying. But in my mind, I don't mind the cuss words nearly as much as I mind drones with machine guns killing people in the Spider-Man movie.
That bothered me too.
No, that's so I didn't, and like Craig said, I didn't notice it as much because I had that reaction with that. I was just like, oh, they just legit showed that person getting murdered in a Spider-Man film.
Yeah.
Like, and maybe that's where we are as a culture, where it's weird that we don't mind gratuitous death as much as we mind a kid saying a bad word. I don't know. But yeah, I know, like, I didn't notice the one because of the other, but it's interesting that you bring that up.
Yeah. And the Mysterio.
And in hindsight, yes.
Yeah. I just, you know what? The overall feel of the movie, the feeling I had when I wrapped it up is I was like, okay, it feels like they're trying to make each one of these movies feel as big as each Avenger movie. You know, because, you know, and again, a major hang up I had with the movie, and this is just personal, it's not reflecting on the quality, is the whole movie takes place in Europe. Spider-Man's your neighborhood Spider-Man.
Yeah.
You take him out of New York City.
You've been to space.
Yeah. When you take Spider-Man out of New York City, my interest automatically is dampened.
I agree.
Because nothing's better to me than Spider-Man swinging around New York City. And when he's fighting villains in Europe, I'm like, okay.
Well, we didn't get the scene of him fighting the guys in the bank.
Yeah.
Like they showed
Marvel's infamous trailer shots. Yeah.
They're wearing Avengers masks and stuff. Yeah. We didn't get that. We didn't really get any New York other than the final.
The final was the best part of the movie to me. I'm like, here he goes. He's swinging around.
It should have been, but I'm sitting there watching going, oh, this is nothing but an infomercial for the video game. This is like the whole like camera shot, taking selfies. I'm like, this is doing nothing but trying to sell the video game. And that took what should have been a great moment because it reminded us of these picturesque scenes of him swinging through Queens or Manhattan, and it made it into a selling point. And on some level, maybe it was just a shout out to the people who bought the video game and enjoyed it. So there's some appreciation for that. I'm sitting there going, oh, okay, this is the video game now. Okay, cool.
The video game sold well enough without this movie.
For sure.
It came out months ago. But I felt that too, though. Even I thought about that. I've never even played the game. Some of the things like y'all's, like I said, the small issues. It's not like anyone hated this movie. But, you know, there are little things that y'all just didn't like about it. And I agree with a lot of it. But what I was liking about this movie, what I liked about the first one also, was it continued the world building for Spider-Man and his personal thing. When they're talking about the water monster in Venice, they thought maybe it's this one guy who got caught up in a hydroplane, got hydro powers. Uh-huh. Like, yes, they're building that. Dimitri, who I mistakenly thought was Kraven the Hunter, but I was halfway there. Kraven's half-brother is Dimitri the Chameleon. So like they're dropping either Easter eggs or potential future things with Spider-Man. And I love that. Also, the fact that Mary Jane was terrified of swinging on the web, I fucking love that whole. She's like, we're never doing that again.
Well, and you know, I think we've been kind of critical in the film, but I just want to remind folks, I gave it a B-. That's not a bad grade.
No, the movie
was fun. Jake Gyllenhaal, standout man. His acting in this film was just gorgeous.
Yeah, and Mysterio's origin, going from I believe he's just a special effects movie guy in the comics to a disgruntled employee with crazy tech to make those same kind of illusions.
Well, it's just an updated
an absolute brilliant way. Like, because when I heard about him, I'm like, okay, I like the idea, but I was super curious about how they're actually going to pull this off. And I think it was the perfect way. Also, why I'm not mad about him getting marveled, because after you figured out that trick, like, he doesn't need to come back.
Right.
Unless it all was an illusion because it's fucking Mysterio. But if he got marveled in this movie, I'll be okay with that because it was still a perfect way to use him.
Mm-hmm.
So I give an A. I give Homecoming an A+ because that's still one of my favorite Marvel movies. But I agree with Matt. I don't like when Spider-Man goes outside of the friendly neighborhood. You know, that to me, this, it felt like they were trying to make, like you said, almost like making a bigger Avenger film. And I don't think Spider-Man needs to be. I think the same story could have been told in a smaller scale, but still a highly enjoyable film.
New York City is a character in the Spider-Man story. Yeah. Just like Gotham City is for Batman.
Yeah, I agree.
Also, one more Easter egg. I didn't notice, but reading up on the movie after I finally saw it, when they are going through Manhattan and you see the former Avengers Tower, it's being rebuilt. And it says, like, coming soon, 1, 2, 3, and then like a question mark, which could either hint at Fantastic Four, the Baxter Building, or just maybe the nice way of saying Phase 4 coming. Yeah. But, you know, I like to think it's Fantastic Four because we also got space and they're going to find some astronauts stuck out there with some weird powers now, but who knows?
The nightmare scenes were amazing.
Like, the scene where they're fighting in the building How many of, I'm sorry, I don't mean to catch you.
No,
off,
I just burped in my mouth. It was disgusting.
How many of you guys were pissed off when Nick Fury shot Mysterio?
Yes. I fell for it.
I was like, fuck you. This is a Spider-Man movie.
Yeah, I fell
you
for it.
Just had Nick Fury kill the bad guy. Fuck you. I was mad.
Yeah, he got me too. Absolutely.
For anybody who wonders why Mysterio can be terrifying, this movie proves. I mean, yes. Like you go back to the, we talked about Mark Millar earlier, the Old Man Logan book where Mysterio makes Wolverine kill everybody. Yeah. Like this reminds you of why it was horrifying. Yeah. And when Craig watched this before I did and he came back and he said, all I'll tell you is that the Marvel writers are smart across the board. Comics, movies, they're smart. And so I was looking at these things while I was going through. And one of the things they just announced were, for the comic side of things, is Marvel Zombies. And it was right after the heels of something you're going to talk about. And I'm like, oh, well, that's just convenient timing. They gave you Marvel Zombies. They give you a blip of it in this movie. And that's why they came out with it. They give you, I think it was Tony crawling out of the grave like as a zombie. And I was like, oh, that's why they're coming out with Marvel Zombies. And so you're going to see that tied into it. Across the board, like I said, it was silly. I had fun with it. I was entertained. Tom Holland is Spider-Man for me.
Then Absolutely, the best Spider-Man we've had.
Yeah, I agree. 100%.
Take his mask off less. Take his shirt off more. I'll be happy. that's what I really want in life. Because that little
motherfucker's
hot. Well,
the way you do that is you have more Peter Parker in the movie and less Spider-Man.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you have Spider-Man, he's in his costume.
Yeah.
So two things that I think are definitely worth mentioning that it's easy to take for granted with Marvel movies are the special effects were like flawless.
Oh,
amazing.
Oh, yeah.
Seamless.
It's real easy to take that for granted until you go back and watch a DC movie for example.
Oh, the CGI in this and the hologram when he dives into the hologram.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just it looks so realistic.
Yeah.
It's just amazing.
Yeah.
And I really liked, you know, that the scene where we get to see Spider-Man being a badass. He's just using his webs.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And he's just doing his
Spider-Man
his
or
super
Night
strength.
Monkey.
Night Monkey.
Well, that was great. I'm talking about the final scene when he's going.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, he's taking out the drones. I was like, oh, thank you.
Yep.
We can watch him do his badass stuff without a super suit. You know,
for some
saying?
Reason, his spider senses came back on.
They never explained that.
They did not explain it. I kind of took it to mean like just his like sadness over Tony maybe was expected, but they could have given at least a little something about that.
I think they should have
explained it. Exactly. They didn't explain it. This is what I kind of read into it but
what I got from that, maybe I just made this up on my own, is that the drone tech that Mysterio was using was diminished and damaged. And part of that drone tech was interfering with his spider sense. I mean, that from the comics, he has had trouble with his spider sense in Mysterio's presence.
Oh, yeah. So I'm okay with that, except for the fact that he didn't realize that the banana was being thrown at him at the beginning.
Yeah.
So it kind of set it up to the fact that it was kind of wanky even before he knew about Mysterio.
Mm-hmm. Which, and they haven't, other than like, and correct me if I'm wrong, they haven't overly used that very much either, other than seeing the hair raise up on his arm during
The thing about it is that you don't have to have him go, oh, my spider sense. It's the fact that he can dodge bullets and he can dodge through
the stereo stuff. They show him furrowing his brow.
Yeah.
They do like all through the thing. Yeah.
Without him, like in the comic books, they'll do like half of his face.
I need the electric bolt things coming off of that. So I know he's using it.
I always think, you know, back when our first introduction of Tom Holland Spider-Man in Civil War, everything about that was perfect.
Spider-Man.
Him.
Yeah.
The show, you know, him being just a kid that's got
making
more
Star
power
Wars
than he really knows he has. Whenever he catches Bucky's hand.
Yeah.
And he's a kid going, wow, you got a metal arm. Yeah. I mean, that's just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I felt that this movie came closer to capturing that than
Homecoming.
Yes. Not that I don't like Homecoming. I felt this was a closer version of Spider-Man than we have had since Civil War up to this point.
Well, he didn't feel like the same Spider-Man from those before. And I think it's because he actually feels younger in this.
And he's growing.
Yeah.
And he's learning that, yes, I want to go do those things as a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't because of who I am.
Yeah.
And that my responsibility requires me to do these other things. And, you know, so there's a lot of growth that happens in this movie.
So before we move on, and we talk about some comics, which I'm really excited about, Go around the table. Who is the standout in this for you guys? Start with Matt. Who was your standout?
I think it's still Tom Holland.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Tom Holland definitely was that. You mentioned him, so I'm gonna say Jake Gyllenhaal's portrayal of Mysterio and the way Mysterio was written was perfect for me.
I'm gonna say Flash. I love
Flash Tom, has been great.
Tom Holland in Jake Gyllenhaal, that just goes without saying. To pick somebody other than those two, I'm gonna go with Flash just because his that kid's playing Flash perfectly to me. You know, he got the hard on for Spider-Man while hating Peter. Yep. he's doing it great.
So. The Flash Mob.
Yeah.
Flash Mob.
Yeah.
For me, it's Happy. John Favreau, to me, is the standout in this film. Like he usually is in most things he does. He's a low-key standout. But he is stepping in to take the role, the Uncle Ben role, quote-unquote, the Tony role, if that's how we want to view it. The way he's protective of Pete, while at the same time pushing him.
Owning his hand.
Well, he's also getting hooked up. But
that's also why he's the standout of this movie.
Speaking of Ant, I was completely distracted by the mom jeans.
Yeah, me too.
Does anybody remember the mom? I was like, wow.
Why is she wearing mom jeans? I kept thinking the same thing.
Mom jeans are back in style.
They're back.
Now.
They're back. Really? You see college girls in mom jeans. Dude, it's insane. Yeah. The world doesn't make sense anymore.
It's a thing.
It's, you know what
are you going to tell me next? That yoga pants are gone?
Dude, there's no more yoga pants. It's mom jeans and fanny packs. That's the world we're living in again. Doesn't make any sense.
I saw a thing where JNCO jeans are coming back. I don't know if they'll work, but they're coming back. We're going to get them for a minute.
Jerry is super excited.
Like 16-year-old me is like, fucking told you so.
This is madness.
It is madness.
But yeah, so it would be Happy for me. I like seeing. I love Jon Favreau. So to me, he's always.
And I love that he pushed Peter to growth without being Tony Stark in the way Tony Stark did it in Homecoming. He led Peter instead of fathering Peter. Mm-hmm.
Also, sorry, one last thing before we wrap up. Another just little subtle nods I just loved about this movie. When they are in the museum or the warehouse hiding the kids, they each grab weapons to fight off that one drone.
Mm-hmm.
MJ grabbed a hammer. Betty Brant grabbed a suit of armor. And Happy had a shield.
I thought MJ grabbed him. Was it a hammer or a mace?
It was a mace. But, you know, basically, Thor, Iron Man, and Cat, they used the weaponry from that. Just a little nods.
Yeah.
It's like little stuff like that made me just absolutely love this movie.
I'm sad we didn't get Captain Britain, but that's just me.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. That would have been perfect.
Yeah,
even just another little nod to. Yeah.
Well, while you have the floor, Sean, why don't you talk about a little comic that you want to talk about, buddy?
Okay. Well, I want to talk about Kanto from IDW. We mentioned this a few episodes ago as one of my short stacks, and I just want to dive more into it. This is from writer David M. Boer with artist Drew Zucker and colors by Vittorio Aston. With lettering by Darren Bennett. Kanto is, I would call it a dark fairy tale, I think is how it's starting off. You're in a world with not a lot of explanation, because I think learning about this world and the people is going to be part of the journey.
Mm-hmm.
But you have these little people that are like, you can tell they're living, but they're in armor. So they almost kind of look like little tin soldiers, kind of tin armored people who work for these robed people who are, they just call them the slavers. They're forced into slavery. Their hearts are taken out and replaced with clocks. Like I said, that's a high fantasy element. They're not given names and they're not allowed to have any kind of feel. They're just workers. Kanto, though, is unique in that he has been given a name by a girl of his race who they kind of have a relationship going into. And that gets found out by the slavers. They find out that he has a name. They get in trouble and they punish her for giving him the name and she's dying. So the elder of his people, like, kind of let Kanto know that there is somebody outside of this area where they're used to just working and living and just being slaves that can help her. And he opened up with them showing like aspirations of him wanting to be a hero, looking up to heroes, you know, obviously wanting more outside of just being a slave. So, and that's kind of the whole setup is really just that kind of introducing that they're trapped and that he's going to go on a journey.
Mm-hmm.
And, I said, without having to read you the entire book, obviously, that's pretty much the setup and that's pretty much the first issue. It's kind of introducing you to the world of people. And what I think it's going to be is like, I think we're going to get into a really, probably a dark fairy tale. Almost, I was reading, I was getting Dark Crystal, Jim Henson 80s vibes, which is the highest compliment I can give a lot of things.
Yeah.
Like, I can see just the way the art is. And without, y'all look up the art of this. I love the art, the character designs, the way everything looks. It just looks like a Jim Henson dark movie. Like, could be easily done with like puppets and people in costume and stuff. And I think it's going to be just a really good story. I got really good feeling about it. And it's like, it's an interesting world, interesting setup. And again, like I said, these people that can remove hearts and put in clocks, these people are still living. You can tell they're still flesh even underneath this. It's really good. And that's, yeah. Let's say Kando, I think Matt mentioned when we brought it up, like I said, this book's getting a lot of hype. And I think it's for a very good reason. I highly recommend you check it out.
It's kind of sounds like it's kind of got a Scotty Young vibe to it.
Yeah, I can see that, especially like I said, the art style is very cartoony, but detailed, like the color work is absolutely like beautiful. Like it's very watercolor-esque to it, man. Like I said, I can't recommend enough. It's from IDW. If you can get on the shelf or order it, I highly recommend checking this one out.
Nice. Well, I read a little book. I got caught up on a book from DC that I'm really, really loving right now. I love everything about it, from the writing to the art. It's to the characterization. It's not my favorite book from DC right now, but it's definitely in the top tier of things. I'm like, it's probably my favorite visual book right now. And it's Martian Manhunter. And it's written by Steve Orlando with art by Riley Rossmo. Got the amazing Ivan Placencia on the colors and, letters by And World Design. So, like I said, I got caught up on this. I had let a few issues stack up. So just to give you a little bit of backstory about what's going on with this, the book takes place before John Jones becomes a member of the Justice League. You're fine. It takes place before John Jones becomes a member of the Justice League, and it's a little bit of a reconstruction of his origin story, so to speak, both on Earth and in Mars. Like they're kind of revamping the entire idea of what the Martian Manhunter is.
Really giving us history for the Martian people.
That we never had before. So on Earth, Jones has been keeping up, he's been keeping his true identity kind of closeted. And they carried this part over. So he is still working as a detective. He and his partner, who is this kind of tough as nails woman with a giant bouffant, which just 80s awesomeness. And her name is Detective Meade. They've been working on these missing person cases. They're, you know, young girls are going missing, and they're trying to find the whereabouts of one girl in particular, and her name is Ashley Adams. So to catch you up to issue 6, I'm going to give you the TLDR version of it all. There was a car wreck that Meade found out, who John Jones really is, the shape-shifting Martin, because the car catches on fire and he freaks out and loses control of his body. And because of this, their relationship gets a little rocky. Like, you know, obviously she doesn't trust her partner now. But, you know, you've got to put your life in this person's hand. And there's a little bit of a metaphor for being closeted, so to speak. Like you're keeping something, at least that's the way I read into it. You're keeping something behind the veil, and the people that are supposed to rely on you, that's supposed to be open with you, find out you haven't been. It kind of messes up your relationship, right?
Potentially, yeah.
So this, in order to have this come together moment, Johns has to be open and honest, and he has to kind of recant his entire life story, from how he got to Earth to being back on Mars, the loss of his family, just all of it. So in the story that Orlando and Rossmo are spinning, and this is where they're changing up some of the history, it wasn't the white Martians that destroyed the planet and killed his wife, Mariah, and their daughter, Florit, that we've kind of been led to believe all along. It was actually this kind of destructive virus called Hronmer's Curse, that it infects the thought stream. Because, you know, Martians, they don't use spoken words. They
telepathy.
Yeah, they have this kind of hive mind. And what Hieronymus Curse does is it goes through the thought stream and it causes the Martians' physiology to kind of destabilize, and they just kind of spontaneously combust. I mean, that's where the fire element comes in. They burn. Again, if you're, you know, following the analogy of being in the closet and leading this hidden life, you can throw in there that this may be, in fact, a metaphor for the AIDS virus, or a virus of any kind that affects other cultures that we don't really know about, and we don't understand how these viruses spread. So it's just genius writing to me from Orlando's standpoint. And it's kind of the story of how John Jones betrayed his nature to save his wife and daughter, and by doing so lost everything. You know, he went against everything that he stood for he put his family first before those, and it cost him. It cost him everything. So issue six opens up with Jones and Meade sitting down at a diner. And again, they're trying to build a bridge. They're trying to repair the relationship. So Jones can explain to her why he's not a hero, at least not yet. His entire existence has become about redemption for the actions that he committed during the last days on Mars when everything he knew came to an end. It literally burned. He had betrayed his fellow Manhunters, which, again, the Manhunters, if you don't know what they are, they were the elite law enforcement on Mars, of Martian society. And he was top dog. I mean, he was a captain. Like, he was big shit lieutenant in the Manhunters.
Make up your mind. Was he a captain or was he a lieutenant?
Look.
He's a lieutenant captain.
He was big captain. Shit top dog. That was his official title. I've decided.
I need that shirt.
Big shit top dog. But he betrayed him, and he did it to save his family, putting their needs above the needs of the collective. And in a society that basically runs off a hive mind, like I said before, you can imagine how this was kind of a big no-no. He's going against everything, all the social constructs, all of his personal beliefs. He's just thrown it all away. So what he did is he stole this kind of, this info chip that contains the names of all the Manhunters who are working undercover. And he was going to give it to a group of Martian mob bosses. Well, why would he do that? Well, he would do it because Hieronymus' curse is like fucking everything up. And at this time, it hadn't blown up to where there's chaos in the streets, but he can read the room, right? He knows that this is, they can't stop this. This is spreading, and he wants to get his family and, you know, his wife and his daughter away from it. And so he's going to give it to this criminal empire in exchange for an illegal quote unquote planet hopper, which is a ship that's going to be able to get his family off Mars away from the curse, which is highly illegal. They're not allowed to do that. And he kept it a secret by hiding it in the folds of his mind. Every Martian has a place called the Hermitage inside their mind where they can stick their secrets that the other Martians, the people who are tapped into the thought stream, they can't get to. So he's hiding this from his family, and his wife knows he's keeping a secret. His daughter doesn't quite, cause she's not advanced enough to really realize it, but she knows that she just thinks it's the horrors of the stuff he's seen on the job. He just doesn't want to talk about it. It's kind of a PTSD thing.
The horrors or the horrors?
I have South Mouth. That's a thing that's true. The horrible horrors.
I'm sorry, dude.
She might think it's horrors. I mean, if my partner was keeping secrets from me, horrors would definitely be like top of the list of things hiding.
Dude.
No, you're good. I will never get tired of that joke. It's amazing. So he's keeping this in the Hermitage, to keep it so they don't realize it. So no one does, which again, just fucking brilliant writing by Steve Orlando. Like, this is the dude's on the top of his game. As they're on the way to get the ship, as he's getting getting his family off the planet, like, things have reached critical mass. Martians are literally exploding everywhere. The society is in ruins, buildings are on fire, everything is collapsing. It's the end of times. It's catastrophic. He gets to the mob bosses and he gives them what they want, and they break it. They break the chip, and he's like, what are you doing? And he's cut his family off from the thought stream, so they don't know what's going on. They're not getting any of this hive speak. And the mob bosses never had any intention of giving him the spacecraft. They were just playing him. They were literally, they were so disgusted by him. And these are the worst of the worst. They were so disgusted by what he was doing that they just wanted to see how much they could break him. They wanted to see the lengths that he would go to betray himself and betray everyone around him. And they did. They took him there. And like I said, they weren't going to get off the ship. In fact, while they're deteriorating, they blow the ship up. It's destroyed. So any chance of getting to safety is gone. And the explosion scares little Florette, his daughter, so much that she instinctively kind of slips back into the thought stream. And Mariah, the mom, has to go in and pull her out. And that opens a window for both of them to catch the virus. So they pull him out. And as they're sitting there confronting John about what he's done, and how he's destroyed himself and his family and their homeland, they just start to go. And he has to watch his wife and his kids just burn before his eyes. And this is the family that he's put before himself, put before everything. He's just lost everything. So after Jones tells this story to Detective Meade, she's able to empathize with why he did what he did on Earth, why he kept his life a secret, what's going on with him. And it goes a long way towards bridging that gap and bringing their relationship back together. And they're going to start working together again to solve these cases. And she lets him know that John Jones might not be able to do what they need him to do, but goddamn it, the Martian Manhunter can. Like, he can be a hero. like this is your chance to redeem yourself. And she has a lead on where to find little Ashley Adams. And there's a human trafficking ring called the Vulture Cartel that she's kind of isolated and she's got a beat on, and they're going to go find her. And so issue 7, it's a 12 issue maxi series. Issue 7 is going to lead into the now. We've dealt with the past. We don't really know how he got from Mars to Earth again with planets blowing up and ships blowing up. We don't know that yet. We're going to get that. But now they're going to start working more on Earth, and I'm pumped for it. I'm really excited for it. If nothing else, simply for the fact that we're going to get more Riley Rossmo art. He is doing some of the most creative, fluid work in comics today. I think you can probably count the number of 90-degree angles on one hand that he puts in this book. Everything is, his style of cartooning is dynamic. It's alive. When you're dealing with an entire race of people who can shapeshift, he finds the most creative ways to display their life, on the page. I don't even understand how he begins to pull these things out of his cerebellum. It makes no sense to me. The man is a mad genius on the page. And he's multimedic. He works a little bit digitally. He works a little bit traditionally. There's been a scene in the past where they depicted how Martians have sex, which I don't know. I'm sure it was a cohesion between Orlando and Rossmo on how they did that. But the way he displayed it on the page was just, it was majestic. It sounds kind of perverted because you're looking at two characters having sex, but the way it was done, you just couldn't take your eyes off of it. In issue 6, they show how Martians give birth, and it's not just the woman, the quote unquote man and woman actually like blend together and form this mass. And in here, it's actually shown to be some type of like praying mantis type looking creature, and together they produce a child. And they give birth, and then they split up into their separate bodies. It's insane. I've never seen anything like this. And you know, like it's not uncommon for me to give Riley Rossmo high praise, right? Because he's my dude. I own a page from him. I love the guy, but
he's amazing.
Seriously, he is breaking everything. He's breaking all the rules because he can get away with it. He is doing so, like we haven't seen, at least in my opinion, we haven't seen this much advancement in sequential art and storytelling since Frank Miller. And I don't know that he can write the way that Frank did, but he damn sure is putting it on the page. It's like the dude is A+. He's so far ahead of the game. He's lapping everybody. It's astounding. I don't know where he comes from. He might be from Mars. We may need to sit down over coffee and let him tell us a story.
Maybe.
Go pick this book up. If it's not on your pull list, you needs it.
So, this one's on. I'm reading this one. I was on the fence when this was announced. But I read the description, and going back to the Martians having sex scene, what got me on the reserve list for this book is Steve Orlando's direction to Rossmo for the sex scene was, it's like watching saltwater taffy being made.
Nice.
I said, okay, I'm going to do this one.
That I did not know that. That's amazing.
That's great. Isn't that great?
Yeah. And Orlando, we've talked about this before. He's hit or miss for me, but on this one, the dudes and part of like they are made to work together, man. This book is great. It seriously is. It's doing some brilliant storytelling. And as far as advancement of the medium goes, like for a DC book to do this, nah, I'm sold. This is hot shit. So, well, Matt, I've talked too much. So how about you go?
Okay. I mean, you've compared Riley Rossmo to Frank Miller, so.
And I mean it. But out of the four of us, I'm probably the one also prone to hyperbole the most. So take that for what
I mean.
You
it's high praise, and that's all you need to know about that. Whether everybody else would believe it or not, it's about the highest praise you can come up with for them. So.
Yeah.
So my book of the week, I went back to 1987.
Ooh.
And I pulled a book that
spoilers.
Yeah, spoilers. 1987.
This was a good wondering year. If I read this book or not.
I'm guessing I'm the only one at this table that has read this book.
Okay.
And I'm hoping to change that. Because I feel like this book is way ahead of its time. It was part of the Epic imprint for Marvel. That was Marvel's answer to Vertigo. Written by Pat Mills. Illustrated by Kevin O'Neill.
Oh, you got me.
Martial Law.
Mm-hmm.
Has anybody read Martial Law?
I haven't, actually.
I have not.
Unbelievable.
Okay. So if you like,
I have the issues, but I haven't read it.
I love this book. Now, if you're a fan of The Boys by Garth Ennis, says this is what's inspired him. This is what inspired him to write The Boys. And you read this and you see that clearly. This is really weird and it's really violent.
All so, the, All yeah. the things that prude Matt Trogdon likes.
Scratches my itch, brother. So.
Is it like watching saltwater taffy being made?
Yeah, with some knives, I guess. So the setting in this story, San Francisco has been destroyed as the result of a major earthquake. It has mostly.
Sounds like this past week.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Life and entertaining art. So it's mostly been rebuilt and renamed the city as San Futuro. Futuro, like as in future. There's also been a global conflict called the Zone War that has recently ended in a stalemate. And during this Zone War, the U.S. government developed a program called SHOCK, S-H-O-C-C, Superhero Operation Command and Control.
Mm-hmm.
The objective was to create superheroes as weapons for the Zone War. Well, once the war ended, the supers came back to the U.S., and most of them did settle in San Futuro. However, most of them quickly became bored. They were created to fight. They were created to instill violence upon people, and you cannot just turn that off. So a lot of them migrated into old San Francisco that hadn't been rebuilt yet. A lot of them are committing random acts of violence and profit-driven crimes. I mean, they come back home, they're on, what kind of jobs are these people going to get? What are they going to do for money?
Right.
So some of them form gangs and start practicing their own form of justice in the streets. There's a section of Old Town where some superheroes rent themselves out to civilians for sexual and violent gratification. They'll be like, yeah, you can beat on me with a baseball bat all you want. It's not going to hurt me. So they rent themselves out to civilians in this way.
Okay.
A few of these superheroes actually become national celebrities and more or less, you know, public figures, heroes, that kind of thing.
I'm starting to get the Garth Ennis.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm telling you, kids, this book is for you. So one of them is called Public Spirit. So you would call him, I guess, a Superman analog. Well, he's recently come back from a government funded, what they call a deep space odyssey. And there are rumors that while he was on this deep space odyssey, he was in sleep stasis for the longest part of the travel. Well, he's being monitored as anybody is on, in any kind of stasis health-wise. Well, apparently there were some readings that indicated he was having some very violent nightmares during his sleep stasis. Now, again, this is a Superman analog. Imagine if that was known about Superman, what kind of waves and concerns that would cause.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Government's not acknowledging that this actually happened. These are rumors. Every time they're questioned, they're deflected. Well, it's also announced he's recently been engaged to be married to another superheroine named Celeste. And of course, there are rumors about her, being super sexually able to, it's all these. Yeah, it's the things that people say about celebrities is turned up to 11.
Right.
When the assumptions are made about superheroes in this world.
Right.
However, while this is going on, in Old Town, the old part of San Francisco that's not being rebuilt, a third sexual assault murder has occurred. And there's a lot of murders, crime going on. But what makes these special is all the victims have all been dressed like this superheroine, Celeste. We actually see the latest victim being attacked and thrown off the building by a large caped figure wearing a bag over his head. While he's attacking her, he's degrading himself. He's monologuing. He's like, I am the lowest form of life. I am bacteria. I wear this bag because I'm ashamed of myself. Oh, it's twisted as hell. It's wonderful. So enter Martial Law, the character's name. How would you describe what this character looks like, Caleb?
It is Judge Dredd meets a Gimp mask.
It's
Judge Dredd after he's beat up a Nazi gimp and stole Rob Liefeld's guns.
This is a, I would say this is a, an S&M guy who designed his S&M outfit to look like a cop's outfit.
Mm-hmm.
The mask, I love the mask. It's got a red, what looks like a red upside down cross with a red zipper for the mouth that's always closed. He's, you know, he's got one arm that's bare and covered in barbed wire. The other arm is a normal police, you know, it's got the logo, the San Futuro logo, law enforcement logo. This is the guy who enters the scene. This is the guy who polices these out of control superheroes. So he comes on the scene to, and he's seen as a traitor by the other superheroes, by the way.
Yeah.
Because he's policing their behavior. And he's not above lethal force. So he comes on the scene to investigate this latest murder in Old Town. Runs afoul a group called Gan Green. And these are a group of ex-shock soldiers, these super-powered soldiers that came home and they just want, they've got to do something. They need action. Well, that takes the violence. So they police the streets and they're enforcing their own form of justice in very violent ways. He runs afoul of them, ends up, he's able to repel them and goes back to his base of operations. And he's describing the scene and the latest victim to his boss. One of the things he says is, well, evidence suggests that the perpetrator is a flyer. Well, apparently not a whole lot of superheroes are flyers. That's a superpower that a lot of them don't have for whatever reason. So he's arguing with his boss that he needs blood and semen samples from the public spirit.
As you do.
And his boss explains that that would be a PR nightmare and totally embarrassing. And it's not clear if martial law wants to just embarrass this public spirit, because it makes it, he makes it pretty clear he despises superheroes. And it's not clear if he really believes the guy may be a suspect or if he just wants to publicly humiliate him.
Nice.
While he's, you know, relaying this to his boss, Gang Green attacks his martial law's home base in retaliation. He repels him again, but he makes a point to say, he tells his counterpart, we can't kill him because it'll create a power vacuum in Old Town and even worse will move in.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, and killing them, the book ends with him saying, killing them would just treat the symptom. I want to stamp out the disease. And that's the end of the first issue.
Nice.
This, Pat Mills is great at creating weird stuff, man. He goes way back to he was, you know, the beginning guy, founded 2000 AD.
Yeah.
A lot of weird stuff in 2000 AD.
Right.
He's the first guy to ever write Judge Dredd and that whole world. Judge Dredd was created by some other creators, but he took over writing for it when Judge Dredd first got launched. Look up Pat Mills and what he has done. If you like weird, violent stuff, that's his resume, man.
Those of us who are 2000 AD fans refer to him as Uncle Pat.
He's called the godfather of British comics.
Yep.
No, okay.
He's amazing.
He should have been recruited with the Karen Berger group because Karen Berger just went over and pilfered 2000 AD talent for Vertigo.
I think he told her to fuck off.
Yeah. He's not, he resents British creators going to America. He doesn't blame them for doing so, but he's not going to be, you know, really part of that wave.
Right.
So anyway, the art in this book's amazing. Kevin O'Neill, and it's, he forces you to really study his backgrounds because there's all kinds of little graffiti written on things. And he always makes a point to write some kind of funny, weird slogan on the guns.
Rob Guillory type.
Yeah. I mean, you know, this
almost like Tank Girl. You remember? So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and this book is super cheap. It's highly underrated, criminally underrated to me. You can get this in back issue bins for $1 every day. It's a 6-issue arc. This movie was this was an option for a movie years back. What ruined it was the Watchmen movie. The Watchmen movie underperformed.
Yeah.
And it scared the studio from making this R-rated movie.
Now they would not be scared.
That we may see it. I think we'll see this eventually because it's too damn good.
Yeah.
Read, if you loved The Boys, this is where The Boys came from.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Very, very cool.
I love Sounds Pat. Awesome. I love Uncle Pat. Like, I can't, like, I forgot that he wrote this, and I've got the issues. I've never actually read it. I got to go dig these out.
I have the first issue.
He's so good at writing a story where the character's motivation is rage. You know, this gangrene group, the leader's name is Suicida.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, his internal monologue is every time somebody talks to him, he just wants to punch him in the mouth. And then at one point, he just starts screaming, I just want to punch the whole world in the mouth.
Have you ever read Grimjack? I got to get you some Grimjack. Because if you like this, you're going to love Grimjack.
Yeah.
Craig, my brother, I want you to drop some brilliance on us. Tell me what you read this week.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about a book that stirred up a little bit of controversy this week.
Ooh.
On Monday, it hit the internet that Walking Dead was ending with issue 193, which came out Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Because as people started to get their books in for release, comic shop owners flipped to the back. First of all, they were like, why is this a double issue
70 book? 70-something pages.
Yeah, why is this a thick book? They flipped to the back of it, and, oh, well, there's a thank you letter for buying my book. This is the end, blah, blah, blah. So it kind of came as a shock to people. And the last comic book I talked about on this show was Walking Dead issue number 192.
It was.
Which was the death of Rick Grimes. And I said then that that is a very ballsy thing to do. A very courageous thing for a creator to do, to kill off your hero with, you know, the book presumably still going. Well, as it turns out,
psych!
The book was over. Because this book, this issue, is 100% an epilogue.
Mm-hmm.
The story ended at 192. So, this, of course, is Walking Dead 193, Image Comics, Robert Kirkman writing, Charlie Adler and Cliff Rathburn is the artist, Russ Wooten is the letterer, and there is no coloring in this, you uncultured swine. So, as I said, the last book ends with Rick dying. And presumably you're going to open this book and it's going to step in right with that, and you're going to have Rick's funeral, etc. No. It starts, and you see a farmhouse in the distance with a walker headed toward the farmhouse. And you get 5-6 panels on one page, and then the next page, the walker's getting closer, and a sword comes and cuts the top of the walker's head off. And standing over it is a Rick Grimes figure with a leather eye patch over his head, all around his head and covering his eye, and it's Carl, is an adult male. So there has been a undetermined amount of time jump. We find out that Carl is married to his lifelong friend, Sophia, who was Carol's daughter that was raised by Maggie and Glenn after Carol died. They have a daughter named Andrea, who is named after his stepmom, Andrea. And Carl's just absolutely appalled that there is a walker on their farm because it has become so safe in the world because they've learned that everybody, when you die, you have to cut off their heads. You have to shoot them in the head. You have to destroy their brains or else they come back. They've learned this. So there are no new walkers being created. And it's been so long that the other walkers are pretty much non-existent. So he starts thinking about it and he says, where's Herschel? Glenn and Maggie's son. And so he runs to town, which is this very old Western feel, and finds Herschel. And Herschel has a traveling sideshow with walkers. And he says, you know, Carl says, you know, one of these got out. And Herschel's like, oh, did you find it? Did you bring him back to me? And Carl's like, no, I fucking killed him. And he ends up punching Herschel. And so then Herschel's like, well, I'm going to get the sheriff. And Carl says, go ahead. He knows where I live. Carl goes back home. The sheriff shows up and says, well, you have to have a
a preliminary or a what a preliminary hearing or something of this that they call it tomorrow because you're going to be fined for destroying his private property. And he's like, are you fucking kidding me? It's a walker. It's dangerous. What? That's not property. That's danger, you know? Mm. So this just offends Carl on every fucking level. He goes to town, goes to court. He gives his speech about how this goes against everything that he learned and knew and blah, blah, blah. Well, Maggie shows up and we find out she's now the president and she's running the world. And Herschel, her son, is the one having the sideshow. Of course, that also makes Carl her son-in-law. So she goes and talks to the judge and the judge comes back and says, okay, so here's what we're going to do. There's no fine. There's no nothing. On your next trip out to, on your next run, you have to get Herschel a new walker to replace the one you killed. And we'll just call it good and go. And Carl's like, are you fucking kidding me? I'm not going to replace his walker. And they're like, well, it's that or you're going to go to jail, blah, blah. So he leaves. Maggie catches him outside and he says, you're turning him into Sebastian. Sebastian's the guy that killed Rick. He's like, you're turning Herschel into Sebastian by protecting him this way. You're making the same mistakes that the chick that led the Commonwealth made that caused my dad's death. That's what you're doing right now. And Maggie just kind of looks at him and doesn't say anything. Carl leaves. He goes back home and he's getting ready the next day to go out on his walk. Run. Yep. And he tells Sophia, well, I've got to run to town real quick. And so he runs to town and he comes back and he leaves the next day. Herschel wakes up and all the rest of his walkers are dead. Carl's fucking killed them. And so he's on the road and Lydia, who was his girlfriend that used to be one of the Whisperers, joins up with him to go on this run. And they're on the run and he confesses to her, yeah, I killed the rest of them and I'm going to have consequences when I get back, but I don't fucking care. I'm Carl Grimes and they can kiss my ass. I mean, it's essentially his mentality.
Right. I want him to have a t-shirt that says that.
Yeah. So they go do their stuff. They come back. When they get back, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that happens while they're out on the road, but they come back and of course they're waiting to arrest Carl. And so they arrest Carl and they tell him, you know, you've got to go to the Commonwealth and go stand before the high judge, Judge Hawthorne. And Sophia says, well, that's good for us, right? And Carl says, I don't know. You know, I don't know. So they go, he goes to court and he's in court and we find out that Maggie had arranged for him to speak before the high judge because mm-hmm. she heard what he said. The high judge is Michonne and she's running the Supreme Court now. And she's like, okay, this is not a hearing. Whatever I say is final here. There is no jury. It's whatever I say. Well, Carl kind of smiles at her and she just scours at him. Like, why the fuck did you do this? And so he gives this real impassioned speech about, you know, this goes against everything my dad did. This, you know, this is everything that we were trained and we're allowing these in back inside the safe zone. What are we doing? And Michonne says, I agree with you. And she repeats a speech that Rick had given earlier in one of the comics and says, I'm letting you off. And not only that, I've sent legislation before their version of Congress to have this practice outlawed where you can't own walkers. They're not property. They should just be destroyed. And so Carl leaves it. Well, he goes in and him and Michonne reminisce a little bit. And she said, what, do you think I was going to let my favorite person go to jail? Well, you know, you kind of get this feeling and throughout the whole thing that Rick is just, he is the hero that everybody needed. Mm-hmm. So when he died, what they've done is they've skipped forward this 20, 25 years. And now you have the civilization has reformed because of the things that Rick put in place. And because of the way he treated people, not killing Negan, for instance, by allowing Negan to live and just be in jail instead of saying, you know, because Rick's thing was, we got to be better. We can't just keep killing everybody because they're trying to learn to adapt too. We've got to start rebuilding civilization. So when they leave the clubhouse, there's a statue of Rick out front of the courthouse. When they leave the courthouse, there's a statue of Rick. You know, Carl
says how he hates that statue because it's got Rick all puffy chested, and he's like, my dad was never that way. And Sophia's like, yeah, but that's the way people want to remember him. So Carl, as they're walking off, Carl kind of turns and looks back and has a smile on his face. So to me, this is what happens at the end of the movie. The hero dies. Mm-hmm. And maybe everything isn't resolved the way you wanted, but now you have like a little 5-minute epilogue at the end of it where it shows the future and the repercussions and the consequences of what happened because of what that person did. I think it's a perfect way that this book ended. Nice. I don't know how else you end this book. You either have everybody killed or you find a cure or you say a civilization carried on and regrew. And that's what they did. Those are really your only three options that I can come up with. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, maybe some retailers were upset because of the way it was handled. In the back matter of the book, there's a 3-page letter from Robert Kirkman to the fans and to the retailer, just to everybody, basically. Yeah. And he states, you know, this book was actually supposed to end after Alexandria, which was, what, 4 or 5 story arcs ago, before, well, it's after the Negan stuff. And he said the ending just sucked. So I kept going, you know, and I ended up with a better ending than what I originally had had. But it was going to be the same thing after they beat Negan, have a time skip, which they did after Negan. Yeah. You have a time skip, and then you have, you know, a statue of Rick, and it just kind of fades off into the distance that, hey, look, civilization's rebuilt and thanks to Rick. But now he was able to actually show more reasons why. So I personally think it was a perfect ending. I think that the way they handled the ending, as far as not announcing it and just letting it be a surprise, I think it was a way to protect the readers that have been on the book. If you announce it and say, hey, this is going to be the end of the book, you end up with a double or triple print run for that book. And the ending now no longer has any value outside of just the story ending. So I think they did it to protect the readers and to be loyal to the readers of the book. Now, does that mean that they shouldn't have done things differently? I can't answer that. It's where is your responsibility as a creator? Yeah, there's some, when you have a symbiotic relationship with retailers, you have to respect that. But Robert Kirkman does a lot for retailers as well. They just issued Die, 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 6 months ago or a year ago at this point, maybe. And they gave it out free to the retailers. What did retailers do with it? Turn around and mark the book up to $10 or $15 mm-hmm. and we're selling it the day of for $10 or $15 because it was a new Robert Kirkman book. So maybe Kirkman learned from that and said, I'm going to protect my readers instead. Yeah. But there's also the whole trying to promote it. And I know the arguments. Okay.
Yeah. No, that's why.
and you're more than welcome to state them. I just kind of tend to, the story was told and it was going to end.
Yeah.
And he told the story he wanted to. I'm much happier that this book is over right now than to continue on. And he said that. He said, I could have went another 4 or 5 story arcs, but it was stuff I was just going to have to make up. There was no more story to tell.
Yeah.
You know, this was the story I'd set out to tell. So why would I continue writing
it? Yeah, it seemed, you know, what he did overall, to me anyway, it comes across as he prioritized the integrity of his story and his primary audience.
I agree. I mean, and this has been a cultural phenomenon for 16 years now.
Yeah.
Retailers have made, you know, 60, 70, 100 books a month that they're selling because of this for 16 years. Mm-hmm. I think he's done his service to the retailers. Now, you can make an argument that he should have announced it, and having the fake solicitations and all of that was, you know, kind of underhanded. But, you know, I can see both sides of it. I'll just leave it at that. There's two sides to this.
Yeah.
So wherever you stand on it, my take on it as a fan is it was a good story and it was a perfect ending to the story. I don't know how else you end the book.
And at the end of the day, that's the important part.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, that's all that matters. So, Yeah, no, I mean, I'm not going to say anything about my opinion on it because this is your part. So that's
no, I mean, and we can talk about it in a new segment next week or whatever. But
well, or our Facebook page. I mean, I have my own opinions, but that's fine. I love it.
Your opinions.
No, I do not. I'm not going to yuck on your yum, man. No, okay. I think it's fine.
Yeah,
I love your take on it.
They're arguing about not arguing.
Anyways, it was a good from strictly speaking as a fan, which is what we do on this show. Uh-huh. I'm not speaking as a retailer. I'm speaking as a fan, and as a fan, I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
I'm fine that it ended instead of giving me another crappy story arc.
Right.
You know, another repeat of a governor story arc or something. And like I said, there's only three possible endings. He chose one of them that I think was the best option.
Aliens.
It could have been aliens, but...
Which Craig would also have been happy with an alien invasion.
If it had been colored... With aliens, that would have been the perfect ending.
Oh. Mars Attacks.
We'll always have the superhero issue.
Yes.
Well, all right. I love that you loved it, man. That for such a book with such a big footprint to end in a way that you loved it.
I hate that it ended so quickly.
Yeah.
That you didn't see it coming. But on the other hand, that's 100% Robert Kirkman.
Yeah.
I mean, I
applaud that.
He gave you a cliffhanger, and the cliffhanger was that's the end of the book.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, nothing is more Robert Kirkman than that.
Right.
Well, I love that it ends. So many times the books that we love don't end the way we want them to, and for this one, it sounds like it did, and it made you happy, and that's what matters. So that brings me joy.
I'm happy to not get another shitty arc.
That's for sure. Well, all right. So next Wednesday, as is usual... new comics drop. Comics, just like Walking Dead 193 was. And one
of them, you know what? Some of them may end without any announcement.
That's true. They might.
That happens all the time in comic books.
It does.
The books series end without any announcement or.
That's true. They do. None of them are as big and iconic as TWD or important to shots, but they do. But why don't you tell us what you're going to pick up next week? Why don't you set the menu for next week? I'm not taking the bait. I'm not doing it. mainly because we don't have time. Tell me what's on menu for next week, Craig.
I was going to go with Second Coming by Mark Russell, Richard Pace, and Amanda Connor because it's Jesus comes back and, you know, lives with a superhero.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm actually going to go with Unearth Number One by Colin Bunn, Kyle Stram, and Baldemar Rivas. This is the description of the book. When a flesh-warping disease ravages a remote village in Mexico, a scientific task force travels to the inhospitable area to investigate the contamination. Tracing the source of the disease to a nearby cave system, the team discovers a bizarre, hostile ecosystem and a supernatural revelation from which they may never escape. This sounds to me like the book The Descent by Jeff Long mixed with the movie Cabin Fever.
Okay.
So, nice. Yeah. Nice. Flesh-eating viruses in caves? Yeah. I'm down for it. And it's Colin Bunn doing horror. So.
Can't go wrong with that.
Nope.
At all. Sean, what you reading next week, buddy?
I'm actually looking at Reaver Number One from Image Comics, written by Justin Jordan.
Yeah, it is.
Art by Rebecca Isaacs and Alex Gumeneris. The brief description says, series premiere. The continent of Madras once promised a start for new settlers, but 200 years after its discovery, the war rages on. Deep within the savage, untamed land, a darkness builds that must be stopped at all costs. To do so, the Imperials assemble six of its most despicable prisoners they have. So... sounds interesting, and thanks to this podcast and a big part of Caleb and Craig is I'm paying more attention to writers, and Justin Jordan was honest, like, okay, I'm at least looking into this one.
He's an awesome. He's an awesome writer. He's an awesome person in general.
Yes.
He has a nice cat. His name's Tom Waits.
No, her name is Tom
Waits. Her name is Tom Waits. Excuse me.
Yes.
Matt, what you reading next week, brother?
Well, I don't like that Craig found a way to mention two books.
I noticed that.
I did that. I asked first if any of you were going to say Second Coming. I wanted it to be...
I was going to pick three other books. Let me name them real quick and then get the one I actually named.
Craig gets to break the rules.
Just kidding. So
he's the pod god.
The one I'm looking forward to the most, and there's a lot of really good stuff coming out next week.
There is. Mm-hmm. That's why I named two.
Yeah. Vince Ryder. So I'm looking forward to... Image Comics, Criminal number 6, Ed Brubaker, Sean Phillips, and Jacob Phillips. If you like just a ground street level crime series with some damn good writing characters, this is your series, man. I love this one.
Nice. And you've been preaching about this book, so
yes.
I got to get caught up on it.
Oh, it's so good. It's good.
Well, unfortunately, our buddy Jerry was not here to be with us, but I know if he were here, he would want me to mention a book that I was going to mention this week, but I think Jerry would want me to for him.
This is bullshit.
Black Hammer.
This is what they do.
Black Hammer Justice League, The Crossover by Jeff Lemire and You're Michael welcome. Walsh. And since he's not here, I'm just going, in the spirit of him, we'll mention that book for him. But I, Caleb, not Jerry, would really like you to go pick up something that's going to look incredible on your shelf when you get it home.
I know other people that like things too, you know.
Yeah, but they're not on the shelf. No, sir. You just sit over there and stew, sir. Well, I tell you to go pick up Swamp Thing, Roots of Terror, the hardcover deluxe edition from Tom King and Jason Fabok, which is going to be gorgeous. It's actually once upon a time, Walmart announced they were doing DC exclusives, and they put all these little books together. Well, now they're starting to stick them together in hardcover compendiums that have the whole entire story. This is Tom King writing fucking Swamp Thing. And I've got all the single issues. There's some that I picked up from the Walmarts, but now I'm going to get a gorgeous hardcover. And you know what the best part is? It's a gorgeous hardcover for around about $15. You can't beat that.
You know what the best part is? Yeah. Is that they're not screwing retailers. They're actually giving them for a sure. way to sell it.
Yep.
Because that's what comic creators do.
Uh-huh. And they're doing that by announcing it, that you can get it in the book. And it's Swamp Thing, Roots of Terror, man. Anyway, Jason Fabok, like, if you didn't read the Swamp Thing Christmas special last year, he drew that, and it's solid. So pick that up, and again, pick up Jerry's book, which is Black Hammer Justice League Crossover, because I'm evil. And we got anything else we need to throw in here, guys, last minute?
Nope.
All right.
Naomi number 6 comes out also this next week. I'm looking forward to the end of the series.
I heard that. I think somebody else would like us to list that. Is there
Lily would like us to list Naomi number 6.
Matt, go ahead. You're twitching.
Without rules, there's chaos. So I'm not joining.
Says the guy who talked about martial law.
but martial law is a law abiding.
Anyway, are we ready to bring this thing home?
Yeah,
this ready. Has been fun. All right, guys, we really hope you've enjoyed this. We have. We love it. We love producing this podcast for you. We love getting together to chat about funny books and stuff. You should come back next week because we're going to be talking about some of the news articles that have happened over the last month or so. So you never know what we're going to talk about. We'll figure it out over the next week.
But probably Walking Dead.
We might talk about Walking Dead. And there's some interesting takes on that. But there's also some other news that we're going to cover, and you should definitely come back here next week. And in fact, you know what? You should bring a friend. You should tell a friend to listen to this podcast. And if they don't know where to get it, they can always swing by our Facebook group where we push these things out every week, and we'll tell them where if they want to use iTunes, they can use it there. If they want to use Stitcher, we tell them how to get Stitcher. Maybe they want to use a different podcatcher. We'll explain that to them. But bring them to the Facebook page. If you want to see what we're reading, we always post pictures on our Instagram and Twitter pages. We're at SFG Podcast on both of those. If you got any questions, comments, concerns, if you have anything of note that we missed, if you want to write us a letter, shoot it to our email at southernfriedgeekery@gmail.com. And if nothing further, go forth. Love some comics. Woo! That was a good woo, Craig. I applaud your woo. Woo, woo, good. Woo.
Flair would be proud.